Hey y'all, this is Dr. Carmen Corder with thedoctornurse.com, and in this video I want to talk about isolation and infection precautions. I wrote a full blog post, The Nursing Student's Complete Guide to Isolation Precautions, so head over to thedoctornurse.com if you're watching this from YouTube and check out that blog post. But let's dive right into infection control measures and isolation precautions. So when it comes to isolation precautions, there are basically four levels of precautions, beginning with standard or universal precautions. Now, standard precautions are also referred to as universal because we apply these precautions to every single patient. Because as the nurse, you have to take care of every patient like they have something that you don't want, right? So we use standard precautions, which includes things like hand hygiene. And hand hygiene means washing your hands before and after every patient contact. Now, this is a test-taking tip. NCLEX loves to ask questions like this, and so do nursing programs. So always remember that if you walk out of a patient's room and your hands visibly have something on them, or you have been in a room of a patient with C. diff or some other diarrhea-borne illness, then you have to use soap and water. The hand foam and sanitizer will not cut it. All right, so C. diff and visible dirt or contamination on your hands, you've got to use soap and water after leaving that patient room. So hand hygiene, also gloves. We're putting on gloves for every single patient that we come into contact with. That is a part of standard precautions. Now I want to mention that with standard precautions, certain bloodborne illnesses like HIV, hepatitis, those are bloodborne illnesses. Those illnesses still are treated as standard precautions, okay? Because we may not know every patient that we come into contact with that may or may not have HIV. So make sure that you're treating every patient the same, all right? Just because this person over here hasn't been diagnosed with something, but this person over here has been diagnosed with HIV, don't treat those patients differently, okay? Everybody is treated the same. So gloves, hand hygiene, things like washing the laundry, cleaning the monitors, cleaning your stethoscope after every use, cleaning AccuCheck machines or the glucometers, the machines that we use to check blood glucose. All of those measures are part of standard precautions. Also, changing needles, not using the needle that you draw medication up with, not using that needle to inject the medication into your patient. All right, that is part of standard precautions. So those are precautions that are applied to every single patient. They may or may not have some sort of infectious pathogen, but they're applied to every single patient. Now, with the next level, we begin what's called transmission-based precautions or isolation precautions. And the first level is contact precautions. Now, illnesses that fall under contact precautions are patients that are infected with pathogens that are passed or transmitted via direct contact either with the infection source itself or something the patient has touched within their environment. So contact precautions consist of gloves and a gown for every time you're in that patient's environment, all right? And I know you've seen this. I know you've seen nurses go into patients' rooms who are in contact precautions and they don't have their gown and gloves on and they're saying, oh, well, I'm just going in to, change something on the IV pump. I'm not going to touch the patient. Okay, well, number one, if that patient leaned over on the IV pump, if the patient rubbed their nose and touched the IV pump, then that IV pump could potentially very well be contaminated with that pathogen. Number two, I always explain it this way to my students. If you're in a room with the patient and they have some sort of pathogen that you don't want and they code, and there you are without your gloves, without your gown, what are you gonna do? you've got to start chest compressions, right? You've got to start measures that are going to save your patient's life, but you are potentially exposing yourself to whatever that patient has, all right? So it's not an excuse to say, oh, I'm just running in to change something on the IV pump. Contact precautions are contact precautions, all right? You're putting your gown and your gloves on, and you're doing hand hygiene after every patient contact, every time you're in that patient's environment. The next level of precautions are droplet precautions. Now, these are isolation precautions that are applied to illnesses that are transmitted in droplets, either when a patient sneezes, coughs, or is talking, because we transmit droplets when we cough, sneeze, or when we're talking. And by and large, droplets can travel up to 3 feet, and then they fall and they dry out, all right? So the good news is that those types of pathogens do not survive that drying out process. So when they fall and dry out, then they're essentially not a threat anymore. So droplet precautions consist of gloves and a mask. And gloves, just because we wear gloves for standard precautions, all right? But the surgical mask is really the only PPE or personal protective equipment that is unique to droplet precautions. Droplet precautions does not require that you put on a gown. Now, let's say you are taking care of a patient that is in droplet plus contact precautions, all right? Then you are wearing a surgical mask and a gown and gloves. But straight droplet is just the surgical mask and then standard precautions, all right? And droplet precautions are things like influenza, rhinovirus, and pertussis, all right? So the final level are airborne precautions. Now, airborne precautions differ from droplet precautions in the way that the droplets are able to survive the drying out process, all right? So airborne illnesses are transmitted still through coughing, sneezing, talking. However, those droplets, when they dry out, they survive, all right? So airborne precautions are unique in that you have to wear a special, not just a surgical mask, but what's called an N95 respirator, right? And the patient has to be placed in what's called a negative pressure room, or a room that is continuously changing out the air within the room. The door also has to remain shut at all times, right? So things that fall under airborne precautions are, of course, tuberculosis, and what we call disseminated shingles or herpes zoster. So if a patient comes in and they're diagnosed with disseminated herpes zoster, then they're going to be placed in airborne plus contact precautions, all right? So airborne precautions, just real quick, what's unique to that is the N95 respirator that you have to be fit tested for every single year. You have to keep the door shut, and the patient has to be placed in a negative pressure room. Now, with all of the transmission-based precautions, the source of infection has to be controlled when the patient is transported outside of the room, right? So you have to cover that source. If it's droplet, then they have to wear a mask. If it's contact precautions because of, say, a wound, that wound has to be covered, all right? You try to limit transporting patients if at all possible, but when you have to, you've got to control the source of the infection by covering it when transporting the patient outside of the patient room. Now, finally, I want to touch real quick on the donning and doffing of your PPE. This is always something that you're going to encounter, usually in fundamentals of nursing, and most definitely you will see these types of questions on NCLEX. All right, so I've come up with a little easy way to remember. Putting your PPE on, you're going to do it from the bottom up, okay? So when you're putting it on, you're going to do gown, starting at the bottom, then your mask or your respirator, then your goggles, and then your gloves, okay? But for that to work, you have to hold your hands up above your head, all right? So putting your PPE on, donning your PPE, You're going from the bottom up. So gown, mask or respirator, goggles, gloves. All right, doffing or taking your PPE off, you're going to do it in alphabetical order. So gloves, goggles, gown, mask or respirator, okay? So alphabetical order, taking it off. Gloves, goggles, gown, mask or respirator, all right? So that is just a real quick summary of isolation precautions and PPE. I hope you have found this video helpful. Again, if you're watching this from YouTube, head over to thedoctornurse.com and read the complete guide to isolation precautions, the blog post that I've posted just today. And thank you so much for watching, and I hope to hear from you guys very, very soon.